so stark. Ich liebe es, ich hasse es. Die Umarmung ist so stark. Ich liebe es, ich hasse es.
Okay, hi everyone. We're a bit late, 7:16, but we're on Radio Cabara, and we are doing a tribute night for Gandalf Gavan and for Das today. This is a really not easy for me, for us. We were hosting Das 2 years ago in the same Radio Cabara show, and we did an interview with Ronnie and Gandalf and played song from their album, and now it's a tribute night since Gandalf, our very very good friend and brother, and passed away really sudden 2 months ago, and it was a real shocking, and still processing it. It's not easy. We had an invitation from the radio to do this again, this tribute night, to actually play Das album for the first time, the new one that just been releasing now, and to talk about Gandalf, to play things from the recording, from the old broadcast that we did 2 years ago, and also we can invite people to call in on Skype and to send messages and to come over. Also, we are on 83A Hester Street, New York, Chinatown, so you can come over. We're here, and it will be great if you can stop by. Okay, so we're here with Ronnie.
Hello.
Also in the studio we have Mikey, Louise, and Jared. We all like the El Kabir team, and we hope that more people will join us. Maybe Karen will come. And Ronnie, hi.
Hello. Hi, Rona.
How are you?
Good.
Doing.
How are you doing? And yeah, by the way, thanks everyone again for this. So, it's a great crew.
We will, you know, now it's everything weird and everything feel weird, but we'll, you know, slowly we'll just swim with it. So yeah, so you're just releasing the new album?
I put it online yesterday, and you can get it at DOS 1, the number 1, .bandcamp.com. DOS 1, .bandcamp, .com. This also has all the lyrics. That's up after... this is a 4-year project with Gandalf. And it's really strange that March, I went to visit my family in Texas, and I showed my mom the music, and she really liked it, but she was critiquing it, giving me advice, saying, okay, see, you need to lower the treble here. And I didn't realize that she knows music and has an ear for it. But one piece of advice she gave me was re-record this one chorus of Gandalf's because it's a little off. So I said, yeah, okay. So I wrote Gandalf, and I said, hey, my mom says, go figure. I said, my mom says you need to re-record this chorus. She said, okay, let's do it. So he was in Peru. He said, I'll come back from Peru on Monday. We'll record on Tuesday, and our album is done. I said, okay, that's all we need to do. So he comes over on Tuesday. We record for 5 minutes. We give each other a high five and a hug and said, man, we finished. It's finally finished. And then I hear on Thursday he passes away. And it's just, I've been in shock since. I've been walking around. It's just, you know, literally walking around. But it's, yeah, a lot of people are in shock. I'm still trying to figure it out.
Yeah, it's shocking because he was 39 years old and really healthy and really young and loves life. And there is no reason, actually, that he's not here. I mean, he's so alive. And his son, Amadeus Marilyn Lopez Gavan, was born a month ago. So happy birthday, Amadeus. And we are recording it also for Amadeus. So he will be old enough he can listen to it and hear about his dad. And from different people, different aspects of it. Maybe we should play the beginning of the recording of the radio show that we did then, because we can hear Gandalf.
Yeah.
It would be great. Okay.
Do you have it on your computer?
I do. Do you want to start with the song or just with the talk? There is
talk.
A song there. And
we'll play
nice.
Some songs later. You know, I'll be... But
okay.
Let's just do... Let's
play.
Mic check.
Gandalf is wandering around cage and he's not concentrate on the broadcasting.
Mic check.
Totally concentrating on the broadcasting. What are you talking about? I'm just getting here. We're just, I guess, setting up, right? So, are we?
Yeah, we're on.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for having us on here, first of all, Rona.
It's Kriza.
Oh, Kriza. Sorry. Kriza.
Kriza, it's from the meaning of Kriza is crazed, you know, and that's the name of the show, to bring the crazed out. And we're on Radio El Cabira, which is, at the moment, we're located at Cage, but it's online radio and open to everybody. And we are hosting today Das. What is Das?
Well, I think Ronnie can probably answer that, and I'll give a different answer to that.
Das is the band that Gandalf and I have. He writes the lyrics, he's primarily the singer, and I do the production, or I write the music, compose the music, and we collaborate together on this. We've been doing this for about 3 years.
Who are you? What is your practice, Ronnie and Gandalf? We know your names, but who are you?
Well, I mean, generally speaking, both Ronnie and I have independent studios in terms of doing installation work, painting, sculpture, video, performance. This particular project is a collaboration that when Ronnie and I met in graduate school, 8 years ago? I'd really loved his work. He liked my work. We have similar types of inquiry, and we also have similar types of... what would be the right phrase? Investigating arenas of cultural production that don't necessarily have a format for reception or formatting. So, you know, Ronnie's worked in making sound and utilizing it for his videos, and I come somewhat from a sound background. So we decided to attempt to create a collaboration of making music produced in Brooklyn in his studio. But, you know, playing with the idea of German pop.
Why are you singing in German?
Me? Well, I don't sing in German. Actually, Gandalf does. I don't know German. Why? That's a good question. You know, actually...
Because we don't understand the lyrics.
I don't. Gandalf does.
Only
and
Gandalf.
I kind of like that, actually. So here's the deal. He asked me to produce this, and I said, sure... because he's a good friend, and I, you know, I have a lot of respect for what he does. However, I wouldn't have done it, I think, if it was American pop, or if it was in English, because there's kind of a gray area that happens. Not because I don't understand what he's saying or doing, but just, you know, why is it German? I kind of just like that as a question.
So Gandalf, maybe you can answer, what is the songs about? What is the lyrics, actually? If you can a little bit say something about the content?
Well, I mean, first I'm going to actually add to what Ronnie was just saying, which has to do with, I think, the way we're producing this project. connects with the idea of autonomous zones or autonomous zones of creativity. For me, German, the reason I use is I am German. I come from a German background. But I'm American. I live in Brooklyn. I live in New York. And it was a way to free up actually engaging in a creative activity without becoming hindered by precedence. In other words, I'm not hindered by German pop. I'm not hindered by an American pop. I'm actually not really interested in even making pop music, or I don't even consider it pop music. I actually consider it more a performative event within which nobody really understands the rules of engagement. So, you know, there is no industry that's actually necessarily capable of consuming this or using it.
What the song is like, romantic, it's about love, it's about pain, it's about longing. What is about?
The songs vary from absolutely about love, about relationships. Underlying a lot of it, I think Ronnie and I, when we worked together in the studio, I consider a studio similar to a spaceship. And you know, I mean, don't you agree, Ronnie? There is somewhat of an odyssey involved within the different types of songs that we make, where there's an imaginary voyage, like from going from Earth, trying to fly to Mars and missing Mars, but then it becomes about internal dialogues that then are just internal dialogues between the friendship between Ronnie and myself. So there's an underlying current of the development of the saga of what is happening to these two people in a capsule as they fly past the moon and go towards Mars and then miss it. But that's like a very, the way the lyrics function are very abstract, or rather, you know, the way this thematic is developed is an abstract.
Okay, let's hear some songs and then continue to the conversation. But what kind of song you brought us to listen to? Continue to play more from the recording, from the radio, because it's really nice to hear Gandalf speaking and explaining about the project with right. You together. And today we have also the new version of the songs after you worked on it, and also you and Gandalf translated the lyrics to English, right?
Well, that was something that was really amazing. Just so you know, this is present time right now.
Yeah,
it gets confusing.
Yeah.
So we had to translate all of the lyrics at one point after this broadcast, not long after, because we wanted to send 25 different artists lyrics so they can make music videos, which they did. So we're sitting on 25 music videos now. But so we had to translate everything. So Gandalf comes over. And he's written it all in German, he's sitting there telling me what the lyrics are, and I'm typing it, and I realize that this is a whole other aspect of the project. This is amazing, because his lyrics just blew me away. I didn't know what they were. So for 3 years, for 3 years, I sat there and produced this music without knowing what the hell he's saying. I knew the theme, because we'd agree on a theme, but it is very general. For example, let's make a song about individuality, okay? We call it individuality, and then here's the song. Another theme, let's make a song about bravery, okay? How about in the song Bravery, we talk about how it's brave that I'm hungry, so I eat you. Okay, let's do that. I mean, but his aspect of it, of what he did with these lyrics, was just amazing. And so you know, 2 years ago when we did that broadcast, or what, a year and a half ago, I was just like, yeah, okay, yeah, it's just German pop. I didn't think anything of it, but it switched once I knew what the lyrics were. So one thing I would like to do is actually read you what these lyrics are, translate them, the translated version, and then play the song.
Amazing.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I don't know what to start with.
The spaceship, it's the song that we were actually were about to hear, so maybe this.
Sure.
And then we can hear it.
Yeah. Okay. Here we go, and I guess and there's a lot of repetition, so I don't know. I'll just go with it. Okay.
Go with it.
I'll read it like a poem. All right. Spaceship. There was a place. That is where we lived. You were beautiful, and you touched me. Then we went outside from our house. There. Wait, you were my star, you were my star, you were my star. Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. We are inside the hole. Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. Across the uni-hole. spaceship. We had a structure. Our kiss towards the heavens, the stars, they shone for us. You revealed them to me, the stars, they shone for us. You revealed them to me. The fuel of our spaceship, starlight. The fuel of our spaceship. Spaceship. Then I do the bridge from outer space to the sea. Here and there, you and me. Float us now for where we be. Oceans now across the sea. Lead me, I will lead you. Spaceship, that is our home. The starlight is our light. Thus we float. Our spaceship, it is a brilliance. And then I repeat spaceship about 60 times. Not really that many. So here's spaceship. Good, it's come from my computer, okay.
Es gab einen Ort, da haben wir gelebt. Du warst so schön und du hast mich berührt. Dann gingen wir hinaus, aus unserem Haus. Du bist mein Stern, du bist mein Stern. Du bist mein Stern.
Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. We are inside the hole. Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. Across the universe.
Wir hatten ein Gerüst. Unser Kuss zum Himmel. Die Sterne strahlten für uns. Du hast sie mir gezeigt. Die Sterne strahlten für uns. Der Treibstoff. Der Treibstoff für dein Raumschiff.
Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. We are inside the hole. Spaceship, spaceship, spaceship. The time says we must go.
To the sea. Here and there, you and me. From outer space to the sea. Here and there, you and me. Float us now for where we be. Oceans now across the sea. Back online. Thank you.
You guys are so great. Thank you so much. The technical aspect of the radio is not so
Simple.
Not so simple, man. Okay.
Well.
Now, were you thinking about?
Well.
Reading.
I think I'm really loud. Ouch. Sorry. Okay. Hello? Check, check. Okay, that's good. Sorry if that just blew your eardrums out. So this is a concept album, kind of, you know, like they used to make in the 70s. And it's 25 tracks, and it's a narrative, kind of a fragmented narrative. So this is one of the earlier songs in the album. You know, we're talking about travel. And then we start, so we travel. So I just want to jump, like, to the middle of the album, where it starts getting a little dark. And I want to, it's the song I mentioned earlier, Bravery, but I want to say the lyrics to this one, All's Well, and then play it. So, Bravery. This is part in English, part in German, so Bravery. We were brave and traveled. Our arrival, we missed it. We thank you and we bid adieu. The voyage continues into the universe. It's getting colder. Bravery, the bravest of them all. Bravery, look at the stars now fall. Bravery, sometimes we meet our past. Bravery, sometimes we cannot last. Then Gandalf, the electricity is gone. We hold each other. We hold out. The stars are now our light. The earth, just simply a star. We eat each other. We change each other. We hate each other. We change each other. Chorus. Bravery, it's time I eat you, friend. Bravery, it's finally at the end. Bravery, I have to eat you now. Bravery, I'm sorry, you're my pal. This is my bridge. I sacrifice myself, it's time to go. Take everything I've done and all I know. I give myself as food, my gift to you. For in the future, you have much to do. Back to the chorus. Bravery, it's time I eat you, friend. Bravery, it's finally at the end. Bravery, I have to eat you now. Bravery, I'm sorry, you're my pal. And here's Bravery. I'll play the song. Ready? Okay.
Eat you now. Bravery, I'm sorry.
sacrifice myself, it's time to go. Take everything I've done and all I know. I give myself as food, my gift to you. For in the future, you have much to do.
Bravery, it's time I eat your friend. Bravery, it's finally at the end. Bravery, I have to eat you now.
It's time,
it's time I eat your friend.
Take everything I've done and all I
it's
know.
It's finally at the end.
I give myself as food, my gift to
I
you.
I have to eat you now.
For in the future, you have much to
I'm
pass.
Sorry.
Okay, so we're back on the broadcast, and we see on Facebook that some friends are listening, Jessica and Jeff, and so great that you're here with us, and we hope to have also Skype conversation with Jessica. I'll send you, my name is Rona.Yefman, but I will send you. But we wanted also to continue to play from the old recording that we did on Radio Cabira 2 years ago with Das, because the way that Gandalf is talking about the process and about his ideas and everything is just irreplaceable. It's something that only he can really articulate, and it's so interesting, and I was just listening to it today, and I was happy. I was happy to hear Gandalf again, and I think he will appreciate it too. So once in a while we'll play parts of it, and now I'm playing. Oh, wait, what is it?
Oh, that's a song.
That's a song.
Yeah.
Bass and Gandalf Gavan, and their German pop band. I'm stuck right now. How to define you? Yeah, exactly. Like, how to define you? What? So my question is, what kind of music you're making, if you can define it? And also, what is the process? Because I know you a little bit, and I know a little bit some secret of your bedroom. How do you work? Because I know that your work is not very conventional regarding your personality. So if you can share a little bit.
Do you want to go start, Ronnie? Or?
No, you go ahead.
Well, I mean, the way we essentially work is I will show up in Ronnie's studio, and at one point we were recording at my other studio. You know, we will just sit down and start talking about beats. He'll lay down a beat. We start talking about instrumentation, he'll start laying it down. While he's working on that, I'll be lying on the floor, and then I ask him about a theme, or like, okay, what is this sort of about? And so I'll sit down and write the lyrics. Once he has enough instrumentation and beats, then I will actually go ahead and record live, inventing the melody for the lyrics as I sing along to Ronnie's to his orchestra. In some ways.
Yeah, we have a basic rule. The first take is what we use. I mean, and that works the best. It's fresh. Gandalf hasn't rehearsed it. He just gets there and begins to sing. And in my experience, sometimes he's done something, we say, let's try again, let's do this. It's never as good as that, you know, the first take. So generally, I would say, would you say it's fair? 25 minutes, we have the foundation of a song. And then the rest is post-production. And then we come up with a hook. Same thing as a chorus.
So it's very intuitive.
It's very immediate.
Yeah.
Immediate. Okay, and maybe, I mean, as I know you, Ronnie, it's kind of the way that you work in general, also.
Yeah.
Fast.
Yeah. Well, not fast. I'll think about things for a while, but then the actual process is pretty quick. I don't like to tinker.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and how meaningful the fact that you're friends to your collaboration, is it part of it?
I think to me what it does is it creates a certain type of ease. And over the last 3 years, Ronnie and I have become better friends, where he understands me, I understand him better. So it's like it's a give and a take, or a push and a pull, and you ease up. And, you know, really the goal is, okay, let's just get through this. He trusts me, I trust him. We talk together. That's how it actually pushes through as quick as it does. And I think that's partly why we are able to crank out this thing that... Actually, one of the best things that I always like about when Ronnie and I talk about it, because we do laugh about this project quite a lot, since we actually don't even know what it is really yet or how to define it, is the fact that there are no goals, but at the same time, we are both extremely particular, aesthetically speaking. In other words, we know when something's right and when something's not right. We know that there's something right about this project, we just have no idea what this project is really about.
Yeah, now actually, some that I want to chime in on, because a little bit of what we were talking about earlier, you know, why. The big thing that does come up is, what are we doing? There's no audience for this. And
somebody
like this show, for example, we have no audience right now. Except Michal.
So somebody did ask me, you know, who the audience is, and I said Gandalf is the audience, which I actually kind of mean. I mean, me too, because for both of us, I think it's just an enjoyable experience. But I think there's something really pure about it all, because we don't have an agenda, we don't have a drive for some ultimate goal, because we're barking in the wrong direction if we do. I mean, it makes no sense to make this, not for an American audience, definitely not for a German audience. I don't know how they'll take it. But
I'm actually interested to see what happens, because, you know, Ronnie and I are going to release this album here in New York in March, and then afterwards we're somewhat planning on actually releasing it at a gallery in Berlin. And I am in touch with a person there who's a producer for, like, an actual producer for pop music in the industry, which I could, you know, whatever, the industry. But there is this back thought in my mind of seeing, okay, well, what would happen if we actually then take this product into Germany, which is bred somewhere else, and see if there's any reciprocity in terms of reception.
Yeah, I'll play along with that, but I'm not all for it. Because for me, it loses what it is when it makes sense.
Underdog?
No, not underdog. Confusion. It loses that, you know, the big why question. It makes too much sense.
So you don't want to be a star? Rock star, I mean.
I'll take it. if it's no, actually, for this project, I think that would be the failure of it.
Okay.
I actually think that this exists on the principle that we are going for something that won't work. Even though we're invested, we work hard, and we believe in it and what it is, and we have the love into it.
And I kind of go along with that, and this is partly how I like tying it into the art world, because, you know, for the opening, we're inviting 33 of our artist friends, be it like good friends of ours. I mean, we're fortunate enough to have a ton of pretty fucking awesome, excuse the French, artists that make amazing photography videos, amongst others. A friend of mine, Rona Yefman, who's going to be making a video. Former, like, people that used to teach us all that. So our idea, actually, this is sort of, you know, the type of humor we have, is that we're going to have a double album, and we're going to release it in a gallery, and there will be 33 music videos made by 33 different artists. So, you know, it really becomes a platform for video artists and photography artists that we have to make a music video, which normally they would never do, because it doesn't fit into their normative rhetoric of their art practice, but at the same time, they have the talent to do it. So,
and I think the best, the most fun in it, is it can be a failure, and that's fine, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, cool, it, like it.
It questions the notion of what is success and what is failure, you know, what is truly important, and this is partly what I love about working with Ronnie and doing this project, is that it just addresses directly creativity and pushing oneself and creating something new without any expectations. So it's a childlike project. You know, it's play.
Speaking of expectations and play, do you want to listen to Mars?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's listen to the next song and maybe another song after.
Okay.
Great. Here. All right.
Okay.
We're back.
So this is real time, present time.
2014 versus 2012.
One thing that I want to say is that I guess back then we're going to have 33 tracks on the album. I guess that wouldn't fit, so we moved it down to 25, so that's how many videos we have. But I was listening to this old recording today, mm-hmm. just so I can get tabs on what's happening.
Yeah.
At the time we did this recording, this broadcast, uh-huh. we had 54 songs.
Yeah.
And we said, so we're going to have to pare it down to 33. And I don't even remember a time when we had 54 songs, but I just think that's amazing. I mean, especially, yeah, but so that's how prolific we were.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a good team. It was such a good team. And we had a little structure on how we worked it. And it was really funny. Like, I think he explained it in here. He'd come over, he would literally lay on my floor and write his lyrics. I would be on the keyboard, my MIDI keyboard, making the beat.
Yeah, Gandalf was a rock star. I mean, he really liked the attitude of like being free and kind of punk, and he didn't grow up on this, but he had this sense because he had this education at the Rudolf Steiner School, and his life was about, wow, so like spiritual and freedom and really go deep. So the lyrics are really deep.
And yeah,
I remember he told me always, like, okay, when you do a show, just be very, plan it very carefully, but then come there and just be a punk rock, just do it, you know. And I always remember it.
There's one thing I want to play about this, and this is going to be quick time, so it's a little quieter. Let me see, 56:30. About a little bit about the process too. Okay, I'll start here. Let's see how this works.
Children and when they were.
So you know about the titles of these songs, and I think we're gonna stick with it.
Oh, the titles, by the way, Bonnie comes up with them. Understand my lyrics. And so he just like listens phonetic. Okay, so just so you know, like the titles of all these songs, Ronnie comes up with them. He doesn't speak any German. So phonetically, he just comes up with these strange things. One of them is called Connectigy, which, like, what? It's like, I don't know. It was just sort of like, sounded like what you were saying. Or another one, Snoopy. Like, really, Snoopy? And, you know, this is like the nature of our collaboration.
Okay, so like, you'll understand. So here's Snoopy. I think everyone right, will hear well, this and understand why I called it Snoopy.
Hi,
you ready?
Okay, all right.
Here we go. Okay, so that's, I just want to say that because I wanted to say the lyrics of Connectigy. Because that was one of the first songs we transcribed. And I really thought he was saying Connectigy, and he wasn't. He was saying, that's not a word at all, but he was saying, the German version of the nectar gives was like, something like the Nectargy, something like that. Anyways, that's what he was saying. But here are the lyrics to Connectigy, and this is the, again, when he first came over, he was like, okay, let's start with Connectigy.
Sorry.
Skype. Okay, so let's do Connectigy. So he started transcribing it or dictating it to me. I was typing. I was like, whoa, this is serious. These are real lyrics. This is poetry. So here are the lyrics to Connectigy. Connectigy. The silence of the night envelops us. The bees conspire. The honey of our present. The honey of our present melts, as well as our communion. Bees of the night. the nectar exists. Bees of the night, the nectar exists, we find it. The silence of the night, the ideas, they conspire. The honey of our present, the candy of seduction, our wishes, our viewpoint, they do not disappear. Lies, they do not function anymore within our light. Bees of the night, the nectar exists. Bees of the night, the nectar exists, we find it. The silence of the night envelops us. The bees conspire within the honey of our present moment. So here's the song.
Die Stille der Nacht wickelt uns. Die Ideen verschwören sich, der Honig unser Gegner wacht, schmilzt, als auch das Zusammensein. Bienen in der Nacht, den Nektar gibt's. Bienen in der Nacht, den Nektar gibt's. Wir finden ihn. Bienen in der Nacht, den Nektar gibt's. Wir finden ihn. Die Stille der Nacht. Die Ideen verschwören sich, der Honig unserer Gegenwart. Die Süßigkeit der Verführerei. Unsere Wünsche, unsere Sicht, sie vergehen nicht an Lügerei. Das funktioniert nicht mehr. In unserem Licht. Bienen in der Nacht. Den Nektar gibt's, Bienen in der Nacht. Den Nektar gibt's, wir finden ihn. Bienen in der Nacht. Den Nektar gibt's, wir finden ihn. Die Stille der Nacht entwickelt die. Verschwören sich der Honig unserer Gegenwart.
Okay. So what are we going to do now, Rona?
You can play another part of the recording, and then, like, Jessica just saying that she can call on Skype and say something, although she didn't prepare, but she can play some stuff.
Well, we only want prepared things here.
Yeah, exactly. So, Jessica, just feel free. Just let me know when.
What about Julieta?
You can call now, or I will play some other part of the broadcasting. It's about what is your drive and your inspiration. I think it's really, really, really good. Okay.
Oh, I think we're muted.
Oh, yeah. And he said, oh, she looks really cool.
are still here today. They say we lost our way. They just wanted us to stay. They say we lost our way. But we're still here today. They say we lost our way. They just wanted us to stay.
Eternita abstraction.
Radio Al Kabira hosting Das, Gandalf Gavan and Ronnie Bass. So what is your inspiration for the songs? I mean, what is your most influential experience as a child, for example, or what's is your drive?
Well, I'd say, like, you know, the drive, what's my inspiration? That is difficult to answer. I mean, I was raised in a boarding school where essentially I was trained as a musician for 8 years.
What kind of music you listened to when you were a child?
I was trained in classical music as a choir singer and as an opera singer. I had to play piano for 8 years, and it was Mozart and Bach and Schubert. But then when I became a teenager, it was like the Selectors, the Specials, and ska, essentially.
And may I interrupt?
Yes, yes.
Gandalf knows nothing about pop music. He knows nothing.
I know.
It's amazing, because I'll ask him, hey, you know, I'll ask him something that everybody knows, Def Leppard, Guns N' Roses, and not even that area, Prince, and it can be Depeche Mode. No, I don't know it.
You know, crazy story, he saw a picture on my refrigerator of a woman, and he said, oh, she looks really cool, I want to hang out with her. And I said, really? This is Janis Joplin.
he thought it was your aunt.
My mother, which is kind of true.
Well, it's funny because also I'll try to reference something, you know, even the Beatles. No, I don't know him. He knows of them. I think one time Mick Jagger, I think I had to explain to him.
That's really, really extreme. Okay. Ronnie, what is your most, you know, what is your inspiration? What is your drive? What is your, you know?
For the music or for, and then we just go back and forth. Kind of we just see what, I mean.
It's an organic process, but essentially.
Oh yeah, these mics? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You just want to hear Gandalf speaking and telling all kind of things, and I just wrote down a few like time codes for it, so it's just hard to sometimes. I have a 3114 Gandalf telling about his background. Do you want to switch to it?
Yeah.
Okay, 3114. Okay, here we go. Okay, maybe a bit. Playing?
Schubert, but then when I became a teenager, it was like the Selectors, the Specials,
maybe a bit
ska.
I think we did this just now.
He did it? Okay, so
nothing about pop music.
Okay, so 31.
He knows,
sorry.
Know.
No.
Fantasize and this make up stories, and that, and I enjoyed it because I learned everything I know. The musical saw. Figure this out. It's kind of like the chaos. Yeah, we're trying to find out the right cue up.
Sound designer.
Okay. No.
A good question.
You found it.
Okay. No.
Okay.
So I had a second part to that. When you were talking about bass and everything, do you guys feel like there's
no? But he's answering.
I myself am like interested in electronic music, and I find myself getting kind of nostalgic about certain eras of synthesizers or something like that. And But I feel like it's kind of absurd at a point. Do you feel like there's like some, it's useful to be nostalgic about like the sound of like a real instrument or?
My mother moved to the U.S. to join a cult down in New Mexico, and I was there for like 3 years, and then went back to Germany for 8 years to join a Waldorf boarding school. And came back to New Mexico, finished high school there, and then moved to South America. And so, you know, my background is really swimming around in alternative projects of education, and then subsequent to that, New York. I mean, New York, Brooklyn's basically been my only home I've ever had. So I think actually we should like put on the next tune in that case, right?
All right, well, she was actually wanting to ask us a
question. Okay, go ahead.
How do you make your music?
So, are you talking the technicality?
It was an actual keyboard, like a...
Introduced me to, you know, Columbia, the first synthesizer in the late 50s was actually designed by the founder of the computer music composition program at Columbia, and it's still there. That one doesn't actually function. The second one is there, and it still does work. And so I actually got to hang out with a person who knew how to work it. This thing is, you know, the size of the wall of the gallery here that we're in at the moment. And, you know, Jeff swears by the fact that it has far more subtle sound qualities than one would be able to think about or whatever. Anyway, point being, you know, these were the origins of us being able to then come up with software platforms that integrate themselves into instruments or instrumentation that then create this kind of soundscape that we're operating in, right? We are living in an exciting age because the type of software platforms that do exist do allow us to come to a certain type of quality of sound creation that is somewhat similar to that specificity. Do we need to work with these giant robots? No, I think it's good for like the uber nerds of sound because they love to like play around with it. But the type of tools that exist right now, I think, are actually more than adequate.
I'll argue with that completely. Maybe I'm going to be on your side with this.
Well, I don't know if I have a side. I'm just okay. It's about provoking conversation.
If I had access to some analog synthesizers, I would use them. I just don't have access to them.
Oh, wow. You can ask in a second. It's right there on the third floor.
Yeah, it takes up two rooms. I'm talking about something about the size of this table. Even a Moog,
so,
you know.
But I guess, so my training is in graphic design, and I'm
so for some reason, the time code that I wrote and playing now, it's not exactly the same. It's fine. Okay. Jessica has contacted me, and she can call.
And what about Julieta?
Julieta, I posted on the website. Just a second, what
let's
you say?
Give out some information again, if that's cool. Like, so people can come and visit if they want to.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And that the address is
83A
Hester Street. And then the DOS album is at DOS1.bandcamp.com. Again, DOS1.bandcamp.com. And then, is that all? Oh, you can Skype. Do you want to give out your Skype again?
Yeah, I mean, I give my Skype is Rona.Yefman. Here I see Jessica. I'm calling you.
And she can call.
What about Julieta? How do I hear myself?
On the website.
Give out some information again, so people come and visit.
Like turn it down.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hi guys. I just turned it off.
Yeah.
So, is that working?
That's the age-old problem.
Honey.
Hey, what's up, Jess? How you doing?
Good. I'm in upstate New York, listening to you from 3 hours away, and it's so great to hear all the songs that have been, you know, mastered for a year since I heard them last. So they are different now.
It normally doesn't take that long. I just had to learn how to do it. I didn't do it that well either, but oh well.
It always takes that.
Yeah.
You can make something immediately, and then there's also a period of contemplation that happens after.
It needed to ferment.
Yeah, it's great to hear the cross voice and yeah, I don't know. I didn't prepare anything because it's still something I'm like processing, not having this kind of close, fantastic person around. But there's no words for it yet. It's just yeah. But I did want to call in and show the support and be part of it.
I mean, you two are close. You knew him for how long?
Well, we met at Bard College, and I was, I guess I was 18 or 19 at the time. And, you know, we became close, though, once we had moved to New York City, really, and sort of had become part of a community in a way where I was playing music. It's interesting. I was playing music at the time when Gandalf wasn't. I mean, there would be sort of late nights where you know, always at like 1 a.m, a guitar would come out and Gandalf would play songs and he'd play an accordion. But he was always so encouraging and played so much music at his house. And he would throat sing. And what I almost played are these sort of crazy recordings from like 2006 of just, you know, 10 people in a room at 4 a.m. just singing for no reason a cappella. He'd be throat singing, you know? And that was sort of, like, it's still the ethos of, I think, what you're doing. It just, it was kind of amazing to see him just decide to record an album, I think, after not, you know, just, he never had music at his house, you know? Like, everyone else I know has a radio with, you know, selections of CDs. You just sort of, it was always sort of live and embodied, you know, but,
yeah, he was the music.
Yeah, there was never, I think, you know, cleaning through his house, I think I found a handful of CDs from, you know, the 90s.
Though he had a Tina Turner tape.
But there was always great music, and he had so many of the bands from New York would come and play at his house, you know. It was like a cultural center, like Damien Quinones, and when I was playing with the Younger Sister Band, we played countless shows there. It's just Basel, yeah, all sorts of great live music and dancing, which I always associated with Gandalf since, you know, probably since 2000.
Yeah.
City.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I love the song you did for his memorial.
Yeah.
That was beautiful.
It was really amazing.
And, you know, it's a song I learned from his as well. That was sort of, we're speaking about La Llorona, which is this sort of classic Oaxacan song that, I learned from him as well.
Gandalf also spoke like how many 5 languages fluently? He was speaking English, German, French, Russian, Spanish. What else? But probably,
I mean, I was
fluent.
Yeah, I didn't. The thing is, I didn't know a lot of times they could speak these languages. We'd just be somewhere, and there'd be somebody that's Russian, and he'd just start talking to them.
Yeah,
I thought, whoa, where'd this come from? He's kind of possessed.
Yeah, and very well. I ask people, does he speak well the language? Yeah, yeah, very, very well, very well. The only thing he didn't speak is Hebrew. Or maybe he just imitated.
That's what he wanted. But really he was learning Chinese.
It's more important.
Yeah. Well, I'm not saying, but no. But he always wanted to go to Israel. He was always talking about that. That was our next destination. We're going to figure out a way to do it.
You know.
Is Jess still there?
That's just like the traveler of the world, right? He was.
Yeah.
Man of the world.
It always made me sad when he'd travel because I'd get alone. Lonely, you know, he was my closest friend, so he'd be gone and he'd go someplace for 2 months at a time. Jess, are you still there?
I'm here. I don't know what that sound is, if that's coming from my end.
I don't hear anything. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. We can.
Okay,
we can. Well, thanks.
You know what, Rona? I think you're paper is on top
of
the
microphone. Oh, my paper, yeah.
Okay.
I'm like an old lady.
This, okay, but...
with papers.
Well, thanks for calling in, Jess.
Do you want to say anything else or to play something to...
No, I just, you know, if I don't know, there's something magic about radio, sort of going out into the ether, so I just also just wanted to, I don't know, say hello to Gandalf, if you could hear me, and that I miss him, and also send my love to Nicola and Amadeus.
Great.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks,
thank
Jess.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Okay, we have another call.
Bye, Jess.
Lucas?
Thanks, Jess.
Hello? Hey, can you turn down your radio?
Hi, Jess.
Hello?
Hi, I'm calling from Moscow.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
And are you friends with Gandalf? Or were you friends with Gandalf?
Sorry, my connection's not very good. But
that's okay.
Can you close the radio page on your computer?
Yeah, you have to turn the radio page off, I think. There it goes.
Okay, can you do better now?
Yeah.
Lucas, that's your name? Lucas, yeah. Alpert?
That's me. I was a very good friend of Gandalf's at Bard. He was actually one of the very first people I met there. And... you know, so as your previous caller mentioned, you know, he was an artist and I was a musician, and you know, we always connected on that, you know, this trying to communicate with each other artistically. And it's actually very interesting for me to hear him make music. That was not something that we'd ever really discussed. And I'm like really excited to hear all this stuff. So I'd like to know a bit more about how that came to be. How did you, Ronnie, like meet him and come together on this project? It's quite something I'd like to know a bit more about.
Well, there's actually a soundbite. I don't know what the cue is where Gandalf talks about it.
Yeah.
Do you happen to know?
I think so, yeah.
I mean, I'll start it, but basically we met...
Yeah.
Yeah.
3532.
Okay, so Lucas, we're going to play this right quick.
Sure.
Yeah, she'll cue it up real quick.
A second.
And something, he may not have explained it in this... recording is that we originally had talked about doing a collaborative project in maybe 2004 or 2005, and it involved a spaceship. That's all we knew. And then we didn't do anything for a while, and then 2009 came along, and that's when he asked me to start to record with him, and it had a lot to do with his mother passing away. That's when he started to want to record, is when his mom died.
Okay.
And anyway, so let's see if we can find Gandalf talking about it. So 1 second,
stay
Lucas,
online.
And thanks for calling. 1 second.
You can stay online if you want.
Yeah, stay online.
I'm interested in that question. I never really asked it.
Okay. So.
Well, actually, you know, me not actually being the person who is mixing or producing,
we can turn this
would rather
off.
Dealing more with the lyrical aspect. It's just like
instrument. I love talking about this stuff.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
I mean, you know,
So
I had a second part to that then. When you were talking about bass and everything, do you nostalgic about certain eras of synthesizers or something like that? And but I feel like
practice. That was my main goal. It's like, all right, get out of the shell of just sculpture or whatever this. Again, when I was in grad school with Ronnie. One of the other people that I was, one of my main things when I was in school was like collaborating with different kinds of artists that have nothing to do with my practice. That was my main goal. It's like, all right, get out of the shell of just sculpture or whatever this is. And I had the fortune to take this class and do a project with this sound designer, composer, artist, whatever you want to call it, Jeff Snyder, who is now actually working at Princeton, but he's the one who introduced me to, you know, Columbia the first synthesizer in the late 50s was actually designed by the founder of the computer music composition program at Columbia, and it's still there. That one doesn't actually function. The second one is there, and it still does work. And so I actually got to hang out with a person who knew how to work it. This thing is, you know, the size of the wall of the gallery here that we're in at the moment. And, you know, Jeff swears by the fact that it has far more subtle sound qualities than one would be able to think about or whatever. Anyway, point being, you know, these were the origins of us being able to then come up with software platforms that integrate themselves into instruments or instrumentation that then create this kind of soundscape that we're operating in, right? We're living in an exciting age because the type of software platforms that do exist do allow us to come to a certain type of quality of sound creation that is somewhat similar to that specificity. Do we need to work with these giant robots? No, I think it's good for like the uber nerds of sound because they love to like play around with it. But the type of tools that exist right now, I think, are actually more than adequate.
I'll argue with that completely. Maybe I'm going to be on your side with this.
Well, I don't know if I have a side. I'm just okay. It's about provoking conversation.
If I had access please? To some analogs.
Yeah.
Okay, Lucas.
Yes.
I just want to say thank you for calling. And
sure.
Jared was just saying, yeah, actually continue with it, the question. Sorry, I forgot the question.
No, the question.
We met in grad school. That was pretty simple. But then as far as collaborating with...
conversation?
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so to be really a lot more specific with this is there have only been two or three people that I've collaborated with. Before I was working with Gandalf, I was working with a guy named Steve. And Steve had this particular energy, like kind of wild energy, and I don't. And I kind of like that pairing. And then when Gandalf proposed a collaboration, I thought, okay, this could work, because I kind of need the opposite. And a lot of people thought it was funny or strange that we would work together because we are complete opposites. Physically, we're opposites. He's a giant, and I'm not. and he's very loud and I'm very quiet. In fact, he even likes loud noises. And I couldn't ever deal with that. Like, and because when we were monitoring in my studio, I'd keep it quiet. And he's like, turn it up, turn it up. He was kind of a nightmare to produce with also because he'd want everything loud. And I'm kind of reserved. Anyway, but
I will take Gandalf's size, and I've said that you are also a nightmare to work with.
I totally am.
because he came and complained so many times. And I said, I told him, talk to him. Tell him what you think. And like,
he had a nickname for me, right?
Yeah. He said that you are a dictator.
Yeah.
he told me, like, you know, Ronnie is a little dictator, you know?
And I totally was. I mean, but I also want things done exactly to spec, you know? I don't know. But anyway, we went totally off on Lucas's question to other directions, but that's one thing. But also, there's a project that I was working on. If you can Google it online, if you look up Ronnie Bass and Gandalf Gavan live performance, there's a project. It was the first time we performed together. I had a video project about a narrative about a man under a blanket, and at the same time I was making that project, I was started working with Gandalf, and I realized that this project is kind of a parallel to the relationship I have with Gandalf, our friendship, and in the roles in which we do. And I kind of thought of it as what I do is Gandalf's got this energy, and I facilitate it. Anyway, mm-hmm. So that's how I think our collaboration worked, and worked really well.
Mm-hmm.
And there won't be another one like that.
Yeah, I think it also works for me as, like, I used to photograph Gandalf a lot and photograph his work because he asked me or him, and I'm so happy. I mean, it's so weird because As a photographer, I just could really appreciate the archive that's been created through the years of Gandalf photographs, and not enough videos, but still the thing that we have, it's amazing. And I think it's the same thing, like he was a performer, he was the wild, he was the really interesting and for me. And then I was the audience, and I just recorded it too. And also I accepted him as he is, because from right at the beginning when I met him, I just accepted him. And I was a good audience, and I think that's why we also collaborated and established this really, really deep relationship. But he was very generous to everyone, and he really wanted to connect between people. And the most important thing for him was you meet him, and like, let's meet. And I always call him and say, hey, Gandalf, I just met these people, and you know, I want you to meet them. And he said, yeah, bring them over. And it was all the time, like, ending in his studio with new people and hang out. And that's how he was, so generous.
I wonder if Lucas has any memories he wants to share.
Is Lucas still there?
What?
I wonder if Lucas is still with us, if he has any memories he wants to share.
Oh, Lucas. No, Lucas.
Is he gone?
I can call him again. Lucas?
Well, he can call back if he has anything to say. We shouldn't call him and say, do you have anything to say? And
yeah.
Say, no, okay. Yeah, but call back Lucas if you have anything. Or just text it and we can read
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he disappeared.
It's kind of when someone's on your computer, you kind of forget about them. If they're not, you know, we're
no,
all
no,
here.
No, I saw him, like, he took off.
How about, can I read the lyrics to Individuality? Does that sound okay?
Yeah.
And then we'll play it. This is a song he liked a lot. It's the second song we made. So we were brand new at this, or almost new at it. This is back in 2009. It's called Individuality. Individuality, it is so nice, but completely empty. I see you, and then I understand myself. You give me a reason, and you are my stone. You give me a foundation, I see you. The water of reason, I love you. You give me a foundation, I see you. The water of reason, I love you. Without you, I am alone. Without you, there exists a foundation. You give me clarity, the water of reason. You give me a foundation, I see you. The water of reason, I love you. You give me a foundation, I see you. The water of reason, I love you. I see you. You do not see me without yourself. And this happened, we recorded this maybe 4 days after his mother died. And half the times he's singing this stuff, I don't think it's directly about a person, it's just in general. And that's kind of the way he was, I think. I'll play the song.
His mother was an artist also, very well-known in New Mexico, and activist, and I never met her, unfortunately, although he invited me, but I heard and saw pictures, and people really admired his mother. She was a very, very extreme and special artist.
What's her name?
Her name is, I have a block.
Yeah, I don't.
Grigster.
Yeah, that's the last
Grigster
name. Zara.
Zara.
Z-A-R-A.
Zara Grigster.
Krigstein, I think.
Krigstein.
Yeah.
Krigstein, Zara Krigstein, that's Gandalf's mother.
And she was German, right?
Yeah.
And his father was Russian.
No, he was German too, but...
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, fair enough. Well, here's Individuality. Are we ready to go? Okay.
Aber einfach nur ein
pessimist.
Okay, and we're back. How do I turn this thing off? Sorry. Oh. No, not that song. Okay. So now I'll do another song right quick. This is a song that he liked a lot. I liked. I think this might be our favorite song on the album. It's called Horses. Tracy, my girlfriend's here. She likes this song a lot. It reminds her of something. Hello? Hey, Rona.
John calling
Kessler.
You, sorry. Yes.
Okay, so the Horses reminds Tracy of something, yes, that like teenagers would write. It's kind of neo-prog, would you say?
Yeah, it was very dramatic. It kind of a medieval story put to music.
And then, of course, we did the song, and then it was another story once I realized what the lyrics were. It's just amazing. I just loved it even more. But, okay, Horses, the idea, it existed. All our hopes were ready. All our steps and all our deeds were ready. Then came the everyday. Then came the everyday. Then came the net. My chorus, run. Here come the horses, run. Run, here come the horses, run. Hey, John.
Hi, Ronnie.
Okay, then my parts. When I was a young boy, my ideas existed strong. But as I grew into a man, I found they don't belong. And let me stop real quick. So everybody, this is John. So we got Jon Kessler in the studio.
Hi.
Welcome.
John, here's a how about that mic?
Okay.
Or, that's
one. Just, yeah, just turn it on.
Okay.
Jon Kessler was Gandalf's teacher in Colombia.
Is it
school?
A very important teacher to Gandalf.
That's
right.
Oh. To all of us.
Gandalf went to Bard undergrad. Everyone probably knows that. And studied with Judy Pfaff, who he adored, and always talked to me about how amazing Judy Pfaff was. I always felt, Judy is amazing, so I always felt a little bit like I'm not worthy around Gandalf. But so Gandalf was in the graduate program at Columbia. What are you guys talking about?
And, how was he as a student? Can you tell a bit?
Uh-huh.
And you're a sculptor. He's also did sculpture. And how
yeah.
did you...
Yeah.
You both men.
Well, he was much more of a man than I was. And then I will... Much more of a man than I will ever be. The thing about Gandalf was that he was so Promethean in his material experimentation. And I remember... The thing he was always using so many more materials than we had, or the production that he had so far exceeded the facilities that we had. So I remember the roof of Prentice, which was already kind of difficult to access because we had facilities on our ass about using it, and I remember one day going up there, and there was Gandalf basically stripped down to his underwear, and he was making mirrors out of I don't even remember the process, but it was basically he was using silver and painting it onto the glass that he had melted in his own kiln in Brooklyn, and he had slumped over these forms, and so it was already like these enormous 8-foot by 6-foot pieces of glass that he was then turning into mirrors, with chemicals and minerals and heavy metals, and he was spraying, and I was just like, I opened the door, I looked out, I saw Gandalf doing that, and I just closed the door. I said, I didn't see this, and I walked away. Yeah.
Why?
Well, because it was against all the rules, and I just didn't, it was like, if I didn't see it, then I didn't see it, and it was much better that way, because I really love the idea that Gandalf was making these enormous mirror pieces that, It was that was the way he made them. That was where he could make them, and I wasn't going to get in the way. Yeah.
Did he challenge you as a student or as an artist?
Yeah, he challenged me as an artist for sure. I mean, it's, you know, I really think about the one of the, it was not with the last time I saw him, but it was one of the last time I spent a lot of time with him. It was when Ronnie and Gandalf came over to my studio to do the Das video. And we had no script. I don't know if the rest of the videos had scripts. You know, it's just like it was something that we had thought about very loosely. It was sort of like, oh yeah, we'll do it. It'll be great, you know. And so Gandalf came and Ronnie came to the studio with some equipment, and Gandalf had a big bottle of whiskey, and we started to jam. You know, we just started to really improvise this process and drink the whiskey and play the music and put on these, you know, these masks and go out on the street and wear togas and strip down. And I realized at that point that what I really sort of got from Gandalf was this, you know, this sense of like, embracing the unknown and embracing the improvisational and embracing the expressive. And that's something that I think we've kind of lost a little bit, the art of, you know, and the ability to do. And when I was in high school, I was in lots of jam bands, and so it's sort of in me as a, it's in my DNA, but it's not something I do too often and often enough, and I think Gandalf was able to really do it. That said, I really saw the, you know, the sort of the dynamics between Ronnie and Gandalf that night. It was like Ronnie had to, you know, man the machines and the cameras and you know, sort of like focus the cameras and make sure that we were, you know, we were running, and Gandalf was like totally the irresponsible boy child, you know. And I sort of got how wonderful and how complicated that person was, you know, that night, watching him work, because he really was, he was so irresponsible and so fantastic, you know, and that combination of the two.
But that irresponsibility is what he's paid to do. You know, that's what we want from him. And we kind of egged it on a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. And he loved it. And he sort of took it on. It was, you know, he just sort of, he expanded, you know, like if you gave him an inch, he took a mile. And he, yeah.
That was actually a great evening. And by the way, John did the video for Bravery that I read the lyrics to and played, about the two people eating each other on the spacecraft. We haven't released the video yet, it'll be soon.
Uh-huh.
But it's fantastic.
So how many videos have you released?
One.
Just Rona's?
Rona's.
Okay.
Yeah.
The first.
Well, that's the best one.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, because we thought about, because we wanted to have an exhibit with it,
uh-huh,
but we don't want to just like release them all. Then it's old news, right?
Right.
But if we do it one every week, it would take 6 months.
Yeah.
There's 25 of them.
Oh yeah.
So we might do that, and I don't know, maybe by the time 6 months rolls around, people forget about the first one.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I've just said it. When I did the video with Gandalf and Ronnie, I was in such a bad time, mm-hmm, in my life. I was so depressed, and I didn't want to do it. I really didn't want to do it. But Gandalf, as always, took me under his wing. You know, he was like a brother to me, like really a person who always took care of me, and he insisted I will do it. And mm-hmm, I didn't have an idea, and I didn't want to tell them that I don't have an idea, actually, that I really don't have an idea for the video, and I tried to postpone it all the time. But in some point he just, okay, let's do it. So every time so we did it in chapters, in parts.
Uh-huh.
The opposite.
There's a lot of locations in your.
Yeah, area. The opposite, because I didn't have an idea. What can I do?
Right.
I mean, I told him, listen, I need an 8mm camera. So I tried to complicate it, everything, so everything will take more time. And we got an 8mm camera, and then, okay, every time I came there and I just brought some stuff and like thrown them all my shit, actually, and they got it. They really, really embraced everything and participated in everything, and suddenly, step by step, we became happy again.
Well, there's something that I told you the other day, but I didn't tell you at the time. Because I woke up late to that shoot, to Rona's shoot. I never make people mad doing this, you know me. But I woke up late. I called Gandalf. I was like, okay, I'm on my way. He's like, no, take your time. In fact, can you stop at these stores? And he gave me errands to run. And I said, yeah, but isn't the shoot right now? No, it's okay. Just get this stuff. So
in
I went and got this stuff.
I'm really like sitting in his studio. It's freezing cold. And I'm like, what the fuck? Where's Ronnie? Come on. It's wasting my time here.
Gandalf put me on errands. And I got there, and Rona had left. The crew had left. Everyone was mad at me. And I thought, but you told me to get this stuff. He's like, look, Rona wasn't in a good place, so we weren't going to work with her that day. He knew that you were sad. Uh-huh. And so he was just like, he sent me away. So, you know, I was okay with it at the end. I was like, you know what? She's mad at me. And then I called you and apologized. I didn't want to say, Gandalf did it on purpose, so you know. But he did. He was looking out for you.
So what was the, of that video, what was the first shoot? What was the first location shoot?
Oh, no, I came and Ronnie was not there. So I shot Gandalf, like talking, and it was just a testing. Right. No, actually, no. The testing was done another day. We got the camera and I shot him also dancing naked in the street with the fur, but unfortunately, he didn't come out. I mean, didn't, but he did everything, like, he was so, like, genuine and really trust, and we did a lot of things together, and I thought that we will do more in our lifetime. I mean, I really thought that it's only the beginning of our, you know, even though I know him for 8 years, but still.
Well, I have, so the other story that I just want to tell is the last time I saw Gandalf, which is, you know, there's a kind of a rite of passage for every young artist is to get a Guggenheim grant. And usually when you apply for a Guggenheim grant, you notify the people that you're going to, the recommenders, the people you want to write letters for you. And that's kind of a normal thing to do. And so I got a letter in the mail saying, Gandalf Gavan is a finalist for the Guggenheim grant, and you've been notified. You're one of the recommenders. And so I was like, what the fuck? He never called me. He never told me that he wanted me to write a letter for him. So I call him, and I've never seen Gandalf so kind of, he reverted back to like a little boy, you know, a kind of like almost like, oh my God, I am so sorry. I can't believe I did that. I will never do it again. I will never do it again. Are you going to write the letter? I will. I am so sorry. And literally the next day he came over with a bottle of really amazing scotch and two glasses. And we just sort of talked it out and talked about, you know, the responsibility of what it's like to ask people to write letters and da da da. And it was like, you know, he was so apologetic. At the same time, he was so sort of knew that he had fucked up, you know? And it was just a really, really sweet, it was probably about a week before he died. It was just maybe 2 weeks.
Wow.
Yeah. Very, very sweet moment of just, you know, me, I really felt like his professor at that time. Unlike the shoot that we did together, where I felt like a colleague, I felt like, you know, an equal, and with both you and him. But at that time, I really felt like, you know, I was sort of, the heavy, kind of like teaching Gandalf a life lesson.
You're disciplining him, and that's one thing about he knew how to apologize really well.
Uh-huh.
Because he screwed up so much.
I think the first thing that we did is the rollerblade, the skates.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
I think.
What's that suit he's wearing? Is that like a 70s roller?
I don't know. I have costumes and I have, like, I'm collecting stuff. I have stuff, so that's, I brought it. And I, you know, it's very easy. No, nothing really. But I didn't know that he's such a good skater.
Right.
I didn't know. I mean, I was just thinking, okay, you know, probably it will be a mess. And he turned to be an amazing skater. Wow, man, he rock. He skates. And all the concept is about returning to childhood and be, you know, kids and play. And that's really a lot what he was talking about. And, like, to make art and art, making art as playing versus playing, like, to combine these two things together. I think
you have a clip of him saying that?
I think so.
Well, because actually, I always thought of our project together, Gandalf and my project together, as really an excuse to hang out with each other, ultimately, is what it was,
mm-hmm.
and have fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that energy is there.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. Well, there's that moment in your video when you do the tattoo. It's amazing. It's amazing. And then all of a sudden, he's got, like, some crazy haircut that, you know, just seems so extreme. And,
he prepared, yeah.
Yeah. And, it, you know, and the thing about, you know, him and his sculpture and his materials is that everything he did was sort of, you know, if you return that back to a kind of a child, like, you know, playing with mud pies, playing with Play-Doh, playing with, you know, things as a kid, he really, I mean, he was bigger and he was more muscular and he had to use more power and maybe like a foundry to do it, but everything had to do with this transformation of material. And it was very much, it very much stemmed from being a child.
Yeah. Yeah, he was a giant kid.
Yeah, he was a giant kid.
With that love, too.
Yeah.
Let's do this before. How about I'll do horses, because I said I was going to play it, and then you can cue up the spot you're looking for, and then we'll just jam out to the horses song. I was going to finish reading it. So my part was, when I was a young boy, my ideas existed strong, but as I grew into a man, I found they don't belong. By light of moon, we set our course. A cast was cast to find. The systems of the darkness did infiltrate my mind. I want you to keep one thing in mind, is that when we were making this, we weren't laughing. We were being really serious. And then maybe the next day, we listen to it and crack up and think, what the hell is wrong with us? Okay, and then the chorus goes, run, here come the horses, run. Run, here come the horses, run. Gandalf's part. It wounded us as the dreams. All the dreams simply sunken, the idea. It existed as our hope. Back to the chorus again. And then at the end, Gandalf says, all the steps and the achievements. So this is horses. And after that, we're going to play a recording of Gandalf. So here's horses.
Infiltrate my mind.
Continue to playing some parts from the old recording that we did because we hosted Gandalf and Ronnie on Radio Al-Kabir, exactly the same place, 2 years ago or 2.5 years ago, and they were talking about their album and their process, and we happened to record this broadcast, so we play it here, and you can hear Gandalf's voice and answering question, and so we are playing parts of it, and I want to play again about Louise asked a question and answering about tinkering or process, and yeah, so I can play. There is a debate right now, but we are not participating. We are actually broadcasting in Radio Cabira, and we are hosting DAS, which is Ronnie Bass and Gandalf Gavan. And they're sharing with us their music. And actually, Louise has a question for you guys, so.
Hi guys, thanks for joining us tonight. Really loving the music.
Thank you.
My question is from something you mentioned earlier about tinkering. You said, I don't tinker, I just, you know, get right to it in the production or something like that. Can you talk a little about the difference between tinkering and making decisions in the creative process?
I like this question because I can talk about my favorite person that ever existed, Nikola Tesla. He said in his autobiography, he claims he's the hardest working person ever in existence, but he usually just sits still. Because he's actually creating things in his brain, and he considers that the labor.
Well, no, actually, I agree with that, and that's certainly, I think, the way I've observed Ronnie, how he works, and in a lot of ways it relates to how I work, where I will indeed sit, but manifest or visualize. And so that, you know, by the time when the microphone is in your hand, or by the time the stone is in front of you, or by the time you need to hang things, you execute rather than diddle, which is maybe a different word for tinkering. I hate tinkering. It's just be concise and get there. And oftentimes it's hard because, you know, sometimes you feel like, wow, this is just going a little too fast, but you need to actually trust your, what other people call intuition. It's not intuition. It has to do with concision.
But at the same time, I think that concision or that directness can also be a complete result of experimentation. But if you're going to experiment, just experiment directly. Keep doing it. You know, don't dilly-dally around. Just do it all the way, even if it's wrong.
Maybe we can clarify what tinkering is, because my understanding would be more that tinkering could be, for example, if you were making sounds with a electronic instrument, that, for example, you could take apart the instrument without having any specific goal, but then you could surprise yourself by tinkering with it. And do you think tinkering also happens in the mind when you say about sitting still and making direct decisions? Do you think tinkering is happening in your mind when you're going through various thoughts that you haven't fully, you know, formalized yet, but isn't it part of the mind too?
I think that's like, you know, the ants versus the bear. You know, our mind has the ants and our mind has the bear. And, you know, the bear, or rather the bees, if you want to use a different kind of mass activity, the bees essentially make the honey, and then the bear as an animal acts as a direct thing. You need all of them. It's just, how do we think about that and how do we prioritize? It's how do you utilize all of these aspects?
Okay, I think we're kind of coming to the end of the show slowly, but... exactly. Now we're present time, 2014. And unfortunately, without Gandalf, our beloved friend, and we all miss him so, so much, and it's really sad that we have to do a tribute to Gandalf instead of hosting him here. But yeah, Das just finished their album, and it's a great opportunity to listen to the songs and to listen to the recording and to honor our friend and speak. Yeah, but everything. Ronnie, you wanna play something? I know Julieta wanted to call, but she kind of disappeared. Maybe she fell asleep.
It's funny because there's only one song that Gandalf ever listens to, or when we were listening to it, and he would say, "How embarrassing." I mean, for me, it's all embarrassing, you know? But this one in particular, he finds it embarrassing. I don't know why. I kind of like it. It's called Das Element, which actually... So John Miller did the video for this, but then we made a video. We shot it live at the Parthenon in Athens, Greece, illegally.
Wow.
And I'll let Tracy mention that. Can we go a little bit longer? Like,
yeah.
Okay. So this is Tracy Molis. Do you want to explain? She was our cinematographer in Athens when we made the Acropolis video.
Yeah, well, I wanted to say, like, part of the dynamic also with Gandalf and Ronnie, even before the Acropolis, over at my house, a house party, it was near the end of the night, and I said, "Oh, Gandalf's showing up," and my roommate's like, "You have a friend named Gandalf?" And he comes over, and Gandalf says, "Be brave, Ronnie. Turn on bravery." He says, "Turn on dots. Turn on spaceship, Ronnie. Turn on spaceship. Be brave, Ronnie." So it's kind of great because Gandalf was always egging Ronnie on to kind of go a little farther than he would normally.
To do bad things.
To do bad things. And it's the end of the party, and the room was kind of, the party's kind of emptying out anyway, but it was just us dancing to spaceship at the end of the night. And so then fast forward to the Parthenon. I think it was the day of our show opening with Irini Miga at Remap. So Das was showing with Irini Miga. And up at the Parthenon, we were going to shoot a video, just some footage, and Das Element for a bonus video. So we're at the Acropolis, and I guess I just pulled out my iPad. We had a nice camera with us too, but I just held this up to them, and the guys are wearing these short shorts the entire time during our Athens trip, like walking through the street, this giant German guy, and then Ronnie. Both of them were getting catcalls from women, like, "Sexy, sexy." Yeah. So their outfits were kind of outrageous up in front of the Acropolis in the Parthenon. So literally just whipped out like, yeah, my iPad and started shooting them, and they started going through their song. And so we got this amazing footage of the Acropolis, the Parthenon, the pillars right behind them singing. It's an amazing video. And then it cuts away to a group of German tourists, some high school kids, like, pointing and laughing at them. So they're on a boring school trip, and all of a sudden they see these guys in short shorts lip-syncing, and then I do a wide-angle shot on the nice camera with the better lens, and then I'm like, okay, one more time, low angle, and we hear a whistle behind us. Like, respect, respect, respect. So that's the story of how we all got kicked out of the Acropolis together. And they followed us out. Oh, and they wanted us to delete all the pictures.
Yeah, that's the best story.
Yeah, so I had learned this before because I had been stopped by security guards once at the Market Fairway, and they tell you, delete these pictures. So I just pulled up the pictures on the camera, and I scrolled through them like regular viewing, but I said, delete, 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 very deliberately, slowly, deliberately, delete, 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 until the woman was satisfied. And Gandalf and Ronnie were like really horrified that I was deleting all the pictures. I was like, oh, guys, I got it.
Actually, Gandalf was really excited about you doing it. He was so happy, and he was like, he told, yeah.
It was a spy move.
So we got followed out, and I tried to take a couple more photos, but the guards were following us all the way back to the gates of the Acropolis. So we got the Hill of the Gods. We were excommunicated from the Hill of the Gods in Athens.
That video will be out soon. Thanks, Tracy, yeah. And thanks for shooting it. Yeah, shot on an iPad. It looks great, though. Here are the lyrics. I think we decided to make the song about achievements or goals or something. It's called Das Element. Thus I see, thus I love. Oh, can't forget. Who, yeah, who, yeah, who, yeah. We wrote everything. Thus I see, thus I love, and the goal, now I see it. Thus I see, thus I love, and the goal, now I see it. Just simply a point within the mathematical similarity of Cartesian reason. Let us swim. Let us travel without borders. Let us swim without shores. Let us travel without reason. We are the element. We are the element. A path created by waves. Let us travel without borders, swim without shores, travel without reason. And at the end, we cry. And at the end, we cry. So here's the track.
Lass uns schwimmen ohne Ufer, lass uns reisen ohne Vernunft. Wir sind das Element. Wir sind das Element. Ein Pfad von Wellen. Wellen hergestellt. Lass uns reisen ohne Grenzen, lass uns schwimmen ohne Ufer, lass uns reisen.
Vernunft.
One thing also is the name of this show is and at the end we cry, which is from that song, the last thing that Gandalf says.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting to me. Gandalf had a message, and he was the art itself. Like John said before, like everything about him was the art. I mean, the art that he made, but also him as a person, as the way he lived, the way he talked, and everything was art. And I asked him on the broadcast that we did about his message, and he was very shy too. Gandalf was also shy and fragile, and so many things. And we can play you now the part from this broadcast. Hope I have a cue.
Great, for sure.
Gandalf, just last question, because you know, I mean, I can't hide the fact that I really know you, and I'm really like want to share. If you can talk a little bit about what is your message that you're promoting through your art and your life.
Well, gee whiz, give me a little easier one there. Pardon the like colloquial language on that. No, I mean, come on. Okay, it's super easy. The basis of my message, always within the work that I make, is this: we are all born with creativity and a critical mind, and life is a gift. It is given. We just need to not fall asleep and forget about it. So this is partly why I challenged myself in my own studio in terms of changing the formats of the type of materials I use. So for me, working with Ronnie or learning how to collaborate with somebody, which then allows me to be able to understand and be nicer to other people that do other things so I can collaborate with them as well, is the same as then, okay, then let's think about painting, let's think about history, let's think about theory, let's be critical, let's think about taxes. I mean, you know, it is interesting that right now we're doing this broadcast, and indeed it is the presidential debates for the election coming up. Honestly, and this is where I wanted to just thank you for actually timing this in such an amazingly incorrect way, is that, you know, this is as creative as listening to the presidential debates, if not even more so, because we're not engaging in normative sheep behavior. So what would my message be is everybody just wake up, but on their own, but not within like staid manners of presentation.
I want to stay out of politics here, but at the same time, no, I mean, really, at the same time, I'm not going to say anything about it. Yeah, let's go.
Finish your point. Thanks. Let's put a song off.
If there were two actual different candidates, it would make a difference. It would make a proper difference if we didn't, but that's it. That's all I need
to say. I just can say one thing that I was thinking about, okay? I think I didn't want to talk about politics, but I do have to say that I don't think the solution will come from the politicians. The solution can't come from any politician.
Not even the answer. Just create something that brings some sort of thought. Yeah.
Keep the faith. The hope.
Keep playing. Keep playing, but play in a responsible manner. We're adults. Let's play, but as adults and not as children. And this is why I think, you know, I love watching children when they work. Actually, I was just thinking about this today is, you know, what's the difference between work and play? There shouldn't be a difference. The only difference is ideological, which is that, you know, work has a use value attached to it, whereas play doesn't. Work should be play. So if everyone were utilizing like working but seeing it as playing, then indeed everyone would be making German pop songs in Brooklyn that will never be published in Germany, most likely.
That's very optimistic.
Exactly.
I'm an optimist.
That's why Radio Cabara. All right. What do you want to do now? Like,
play
more songs. Yeah.
We end with a song.
Yeah.
Okay. Hold on. Let me.
We love Das. That was the end of the broadcast last time. We shout.
Let's see. Spy Kids. Actually, that's a weird. I think I started with that one. That's Gandalf really liked that track a lot. It's so twisted. And it's called Spy Kids. Glock is too weird. Let's do Ish B'nish.
Yeah.
It's a nice little playful song, speaking of play. I'm not even going to read the lyrics. I'll just play it. And, yeah.
Then I have another. You said something about teaching, why I teach. Then we can play it after.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll play this, and you want to cue it up?
Yeah, you play.
Okay, cool.
Bin ich und du bist du. Ich bin ich und du bist du. Die Wirklichkeit verändert uns. Lass das.
Check. Yeah, we're on. Okay. So I think we have one more sound clip to do. Just so you know, this album is available. DOS1, the number one, .bandcamp.com. It'll be on iTunes next week. But if you want it now, you can get it here. Again, the videos, we're going to release those. While Ron is queuing this up, how about I just put on another track? Does that sound okay?
Sounds great.
Okay. You have no choice, really. Okay, this track's called Mars. Here we go.
I can't find it right now.
Okay. Rona can't find what she was looking for, but let's just... So it's 9:20. We're past our... Do you want to call it a day here? After, you know?
What?
Do you want to call it a day? Do you want?
Yeah, I mean, there is also when we can hear the tea say goodbye.
We can hear what?
The tea... Actually, the last song that you played then was also Ish Vinisht.
Was it?
And Snoopy.
Snoopy, okay. Yeah.
And we can hear also Snoopy, and we can hear him say goodbye and thank you when you know, from...
Okay, how about this? How about...
Play, do you want Snoopy.
Me play Snoopy? I think
maybe
I...
you can read the lyrics or something and then play
yeah,
it.
Yeah, sure.
I can find him say goodbye.
Here's Snoopy, and here are the lyrics. Our time... Snoopy is the name. Our time is vanishing, like the fog of our perception. The place, the time, our compass of our hierarchy, a historicity. Thus we spin, thus we play, without hierarchies. Thus we spin, thus we play, without hierarchies. Our bureaucracy, our defense systems, an addition and our search of our communion. You live in search, I also live, and we each see each other. Thus we spin, thus we play, without hierarchies. Thus we spin, thus we play, without hierarchies. The world, our scaffold. The past, simply a monument, a painting. And here's what the song Snoopy sounds like.
Oh. untergehört. Die Vergangenheit einfach nur ein Mahnmal einer Malerei.
Okay, this is John again. I just wanted to say one more thing, which it strikes me when I'm hearing these songs and thinking about Gandalf and thinking about the art he made and the way he sort of moved through the world physically, that the physical body of Gandalf is kind of almost like a throwback, and a throwback that I think that there's a lot of fear of in terms of the sort of almost expressionist artist. You know, he wasn't, I mean, yes, he probably was, you know, macho, but he wasn't the model of the 50s expressionist artist, but he was so deeply involved with his art and the world physically. And I think that there's, what strikes me when thinking about him is how detached we are from that at this point, that there, the sort of the model of the ideal artist is someone who doesn't even touch their work, or the, you know, the sort of the studio as production is kind of like a clean factory. And Gandalf is really, everything about him was so deeply sort of sooty and industrial revolution and you know, muscular and sweaty and stinky. Gandalf was really stinky. And that's what I loved about him. And that's what I miss about him.
He was too sensitive to be that 1950s model.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Way too sensitive. I guess we're going to close it out with a soundbite. You got it or no?
I don't know if I got it. I think I'm too excited and it's really emotional for me.
Okay, well, let's put on another song.
I will try.
Oh, you're going to try it? Okay.
I will try. I don't know. I mean, let's try. It's very hard to just to tune here. But yeah. I am really excited also about people who are posting on Facebook and like listening to us and just saying things, and really appreciate that they can listen to the recording of Gandalf and to this tribute night, and it's really nice.
And we're going to put this online again, so...
Let's see if I can find Gandalf, the Say Goodbye of the last recording that we did then.
Okay.
It was here.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. The pleasure was absolutely mine, and I'm actually glad to see that there is such an initiative going on. And I had a great time, so, you know, whatever.
That's the most important thing, and, yeah.
I know, we're probably heading out, but do you want to, what exactly?
Cool. I think that's it. I mean, the most important thing is having fun. That's Gandalf's words. He's like, he wants everyone to fly. I always say, like, I want you to fly! Fly! And, yeah, that's the message. And today we're celebrating also 1 month old to Amadeus, Gandalf's son, Amadeus Merlin Lopez Gavan, and we want to say hi to Nicola, his life partner, and that we love her so much, and we are still here. Together in the spaceship. And, yeah. And we'll meet again, right? Because love is forever. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So I'll end with this track.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Well,
thanks, all y'all. And thank you.
I played it, you play.
Okay. All right, here's a song called Hi Matt.
Great.
Said the father to the son,
sun is coming through the sky.
Did we really have to run?
It is time for me to die.
Said the son to the dad,
stars are no longer alive.
We've lost all that we've had.
Light creates a brand new time.
sun.
Sun is coming through the sky.
We really didn't have to run.
It is time for not to die.
Said the sun to the dead.
Stars are no longer alive.
But we've lost all that we had.
Light creates a brand of time.
Ich kannte dich.
Lost all.